As you know, it's Mother's Day. If you've been here very long, you know my mama died 4 years ago. This is my fourth Mother's Day without mama. I wore a red tie today because red was mama's favorite color, all right? When mama wore red, she said, look out, mama's here, all right? So I wore red in honor of mama. I have still every Mother's Day, I have still gone and shopped for a Mother's Day card. It was something that got started very early with me. When I had my own money, I started going and buying Mama's Day cards. And it was sort of the tradition between my mama and I that one year would be a humorous card and one year would be a serious card. We rotated years. And Dad informed me today he still has this particular card. It's one mama saved from many, many years ago. I think I was 16 or 17 when I bought one of the best funny cards I think I ever gave to her. And it was when they first started coming out with the big cards, you know, the big ones. And so on the front of this one, it was just very simple. It just said, Happy Mother's Day in big letters, and it had a picture of a hippo on it. And when you opened up the card, the mouth of the hippo opened up, and it said, From your big mouth kid. All right? She liked that one because I told the truth in that one. Anyway, this year was a year for a serious card for Mama, so I went shopping, and this one was absolutely perfect. It says, you are an amazing mother. You didn't just give me life, you've given me a great life. You didn't just raise me, but you helped me grow. You didn't just take care of me, but you cared about me. You didn't just encourage me, you believed in me. You didn't just love me, but you loved me unconditionally. You're not just an amazing mama, you're the most amazing. Happy Mother's Day, Mom. And I added a footnote. You were always in my heart, Mom. I sense your love. You were always in my head, Mom. I still hear your voice. You're always in my hopes, Mom. I know your future is my future too. I love you. Your best son, Tim. For those of you who don't know, I am her only son. In Proverbs chapter 29, verse 18, and this is not a specific Mother's Day sermon, but there are some parts I draw from that. But Proverbs 29, 18, many of you know this verse, though you may not know its address. But where there is no vision, the people perish. Where there is no vision, the people perish. But he or she that keeps the truth, happy are they. You see, without a vision, we are like a rock that has been skipped on the top of a lake somewhere. That rock cannot guide itself. It has no idea where it's going to end. It's just someplace it is going to fall to the bottom of the pond. You and I, without a vision, we have no control in our lives. Helen Keller was once asked, what would be worse than being born blind? And her reply to that question was this: having sight but no vision. It would be worse for me to have my vision, my eyesight, but have no vision about my life. Do you have vision? What a profound statement from a girl who was born into this world deaf and blind. She could not help how she arrived in this world, but she could choose how she would leave this world. I didn't know about Helen Keller until this week. She's the very first person who was born both deaf and blind to earn a 4-year Bachelor of Arts degree from a university. Let me suggest to you today, we cannot help how we came in this world. We didn't get to choose our parents. We didn't get to choose our social status. We didn't get to choose our giftedness or our lack of giftedness. But we do. We do choose how we will leave this world. And the wise man said, without a vision, you'll perish. The word vision means sight, dreams, revelations, enlightenment. And I think the latter two are what God means when he talks about this here, is the ability to be enlightened about his plans and his purpose, to dream the dreams that God has in store for us. The word perish simply means to die or expire, and people without vision, without the dreams, without the enlightenment of God, all that looms ahead of them is death. Where with Christ, he says, we've got life more abundant. Do you have a vision for your life? Do you know that the church has a vision statement here for our church? Did you know that? It's on the back of your bulletin every single Sunday. But I know that once you've seen something there 3 weeks in a row, it becomes invisible. Okay? So last week, what did we do with that vision statement? We put it on the very front of your bulletin in color. Okay? And it was there. And it may not be the sexiest vision statement you've ever heard in your life, but it captures the heart of what the leadership of this church 20 years ago, when we sat down to think it through, really wanted to have accomplished in our life through our ministry. And it was to compellingly communicate, not bore people to death. Okay? And this isn't just what takes place from the platform or the pulpit. This is to be our own lives out in the world. It's to be from a Sunday school classroom. It's to be from a youth group. It's to be from a women's ministries event, from a men's function. It is to be your engagement in your neighborhood that we compellingly, with interest and enthusiasm, communicate that Jesus Christ is sufficient for whatever the needs of those that God gives us the privilege of crossing paths with. So whether they are young, or whether they are old, that's my daddy, okay? I could have picked on our 95-year-old today, okay? Whether you are young or whether you are old, whether you are a man or a woman, the opportunity to communicate to you that God loves you, cares about you, and is sufficient to meet your need and will go beyond your wildest dreams if you will trust His vision and purpose for your life. And that is our vision at New Hope. So I want to talk about vision for a little bit today. First thing I want to talk about is a vision is the ability to see. Paul Hovey, not Paul Harvey, okay, different guy. A writer by the name of Paul Hovey once said, "A blind man's world is bound by the limits of his touch. An ignorant man's world is bound by the limits of his knowledge. A great man's world is bound by the limits of his vision." What is your vision? How is your vision? Because the sight I'm talking about right now is not how good is your eyesight. Is it 20/20? I'm talking about what, and folks, I had horrible vision when I had a cataract. They removed the cataract. I got 20/15. Okay? Some of us spiritually need a little surgery. We need a spiritual cataract removed, something that's creating blind spots in our ability to see the vision and the purpose and the plans that God has in store for us. Listen to what is written by the writer of Hebrews in chapter 11, verses 24 through 27 about a guy named Moses. It says, "By faith Moses, when he had grown up..." Now here's a funny point. They're going to talk about two times in Moses' life in these next two verses. They're going to talk about when he was 40 years old and when he was 80 years old. He finally grew up. It took him till 40. You know, I got a son I'm a little worried about, all right? He's 32. I found great encouragement from here today. He got 8 more years, all right? But you know what? That still wasn't enough. It took Moses till 80 to finally be grown up, to fulfill the real vision that God has for his life. So it doesn't make any difference if you're 8 or 80. There is still time for you to catch the vision that God has for your life. It says, "By faith Moses," but he couldn't see this any other way except by faith. "When he grew up, he refused to be known as the son of Pharaoh's daughter." So he was the adopted son of Pharaoh, Pharaoh's daughter. He was the adopted grandson of Pharaoh. What does that mean? That means he lived in the nicest house on the block. It means, man, at age 16, he had a brand new chariot of his own. It meant, man, he had the biggest screen in the city. And he had the best games. But at 40... Moses said, I'd rather be identified with the real people I belong to, the nation of Israel, though they are in slavery, than I had be known as the next Pharaoh of Egypt. The problem is, when he saw God's vision, he forgot that the one who gives us the vision also provides us the resources to accomplish the vision. You see, God is the dynamic of his own demands. When God makes a demand on us, he provides us what we need to carry it out. And we get into trouble when we catch the vision, but we try to accomplish out of our own ability what can only be accomplished out of God's ability in and through us. You remember what a definition of a miracle is? When there is no other explanation but God. And so when God gives a plan and a vision to us, the only explanation for that plan and that vision being carried out is God working in and through us. And Moses saw the plan, he saw the vision, and he got excited about it. But then he decided to try to accomplish it in his own effort. And it took him 40 more years of wandering around in a wilderness before he finally grew up. And at age 80, he got to accomplish God's purpose and God's vision. Moses regarded disgrace for the sake of Christ as of greater value than the treasures of Egypt. He said, I'd rather roam in a wilderness than have the pleasures of Egypt. That's tough. Why? Because he was looking ahead. He had vision. He was looking ahead to his reward. And by faith, he left Egypt, not afraid of the king's anger. He persevered because he saw him who is invisible. He had vision. What are we talking about? That Moses had spiritual vision. Moses had never brought anybody out of captivity before. He had no clue the course that was laid ahead of him. He just knew that God had given him a vision of something that was to come to pass in the future. And as he stared into the burning bush, it was revealed to him what his future would be. Remember, it was Helen Keller who said, what could be worse than being born blind? And she said, having sight without vision. And I think Moses would agree with her. Humanly speaking, Moses blew it when he refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. He gave up all the luxuries of this world. And some are saying, wow, but think how much more Moses could have done with all that money that would have been his had he been the Pharaoh. Then who would have gotten credit for getting something accomplished? Moses, rather than God. Moses' vision enabled him to see a more important world, the spiritual over the physical. In the Gospel of Mark chapter 5, a ruler of a synagogue had a daughter who was very sick and he thought she was going to die. And he runs to find Jesus, the one he had heard the stories about that was a miracle worker. And he ran and he found him and he said, could you come with me back to my house? I think my daughter is about to die. When they arrived at the house, a group of people came out of his daughter's bedroom and told him it was too late, that his daughter had died. And Jesus looked at the friends coming out and said, I think maybe you guys haven't really seen what's going on here. He said, she's not dead. And they said to Jesus, ah, you're nuts. Yes, she is. We've seen dead people before. Jesus looked at the father, Jairus, and he said, just believe. Just believe. What was he saying? He was saying to Jairus, the father, don't be afraid. Just believe. Jesus was saying, don't look at just the physical evidence. There is something greater at work going on here. Maybe the reason that some of you have never responded to the vision that God has given to you and you've been very clear about it is because you were afraid. I'll be honest, most visions that God gives to us should scare us to death. If it's not, it's probably not God's vision. But he says to us in that moment, don't be afraid. You see, to see the unseen, quite often we will have to ignore what the physical sighted people will say. Because many folks are going to say to you when you catch the vision of God and you share with them, this is what God wants to do in my life. They're going to say, you're nuts. You're crazy. Well, why would you do that? Why would the Actus family give up a good job at Clovis East High School? Why would they take four beautiful daughters, 10 years and younger, and go to the country of Colombia to spend the rest of their lives? Because that was the vision that God gave to them. And guys, I don't want you to panic. God's not going to call most of you to go to Colombia. Okay? But here's the deal. If he did, you'd be happier in Colombia than you are right here. Okay? You'd be safer in Colombia than you are right here if that was God's plan and purpose for you. But the vast majority of it, he just simply wants you to get out of your homes. He wants you to be willing to say, I am a lover of Jesus Christ in this present world. Our neighborhoods, the people who live next to us, they need to know about Christ. As you know, Shelly and I, we're thinking about moving, all right? It's you know, up and down roller coaster thing, all right? And just 2 miles from where we are now, all right? 3 miles. Occurred to me the other day. I haven't even said this to Shelly. Have I really recognized my neighborhood as a mission field for me? I mean, we've got folks who are in our church every direction from where we live. I can go about 200 yards south, and there's the Fish family. And I can go about 100 yards to the west, and there's the Robertsons. And I can go about 300 yards to the east, and there's the Dunlaps. And I can go about 75 yards to the north, and there's the Oars, okay? They have both Oars in our neighborhood. And came with Al by myself. But what about the people in between the Oars and the Rolens? And what about the people between the Robertsons and the Rolens and the Dunlaps and the Rolens and the Fishes and the Rolens? Tim, if I say yes and it's okay to go to a new place, are you going to be salt and light in that neighborhood? No, I know other people in our church live there. But are you going to add to the light? You're going to add to the salt? Or is it just going to be your hideaway, your retreat? I've called you to be in the world. To see the unseen, we must sometimes disregard what the world says. You know what the word disregard literally means in its original translation? I love this for today as we talk about vision. It means to turn a blind eye. Sometimes you and I must turn a blind eye to what the world says. Hey, you ought to have a better car. You ought to have a better house. Hey, your kids ought to be the best at this. Sometimes we have to listen for the many ways in which God speaks to us. Sometimes God speaks to us in that still small voice within our inner being. As we are studying the Word, His Word brings to our attention. As some of you know, 8 o'clock service 2 years ago is when it was clear to me that I was to go to Africa. I didn't want to go to Africa. I'd been invited to go to Africa. I had no intention, no desire at all. I'm happy to raise money. I'm happy to send folks, but not me, Lord. I'm a Clovis guy. I'm country. He said, yeah, Africa country. But it was right in the middle of a prayer, right in the middle of a prayer. It was obvious. It wasn't a booming voice. Nobody else in the room heard it. But if you were part of that 8 o'clock service that morning, right in the middle of prayer, I'm praying about one thing. I said, oh, God, I guess I'm going to Africa. It was just clear. Sometimes there are circumstances and other people that God will use to speak into our life and let us know, this is my purpose, this is my plan, this is my direction for you. And sometimes God uses multiple ways. I remember, and if you've been here a while, you've heard tell the story. I knew I was called to preach when I was 10 years of age. Who's going to believe a 10-year-old? I can tell you right where I was. In a rocking chair at some friends of my grandparents in Oklahoma, in a room by myself. My grandfather had died in January. This was July. And I sat in that rocking chair and I cried because I knew the vision God had for my life and who's going to believe me. At 15, that vision is still there, but at 15, I don't want to say anything. They might have believed me, but I didn't want to believe it. And I remember Sunday afternoon, a lifetime friend, spending the day together, said, you're in trouble. I said, what do you mean? She said, your life is troubled. I said, no, life's good. She says, no. She says, God's wanting you to preach, isn't he? And you don't want to say yes. I was really polite. I said, shut up. We talked some more. And she said, I tell you what, tonight, if God makes it really clear in the evening message that this is his direction for you, you need to stand and speak up. You need to not put this off anymore. I said, okay. I felt really comfortable saying okay because Dad had a guest speaker at church that night, and his name was Bob Shockey, and he's a West Virginia guy. And this guy was a great storyteller, told lots of jokes. He'd do that for about 35 minutes, preach for about 15 minutes, and then give a 20-minute altar call. And I figured there's no way in the world he's going to say anything that's going to hit me right where I am. That night when Dad introduced him and he took the pulpit, he did not tell one story. He did not crack one joke. He said, turn with me to the book of Corinthians. And he read this verse, first words out of his mouth, by the foolishness of preaching, God will win the world. Debbie looked at me and said, now tell me to shut up. But sometimes God takes circumstances, God takes the quiet voice, and God takes his word, and God takes the voice of others to draw us into a relationship of his vision and purpose. We must not be controlled by the logical. Believe there is more to life than what meets the eye. Too often we are guilty of limiting God. And how is it that we limit God? We limit God when we don't seek God's plan and vision for everything. I mean everything in our lives. All right? There's not some things which are spiritual and some things that are not spiritual. Everything in our life, if we say that Jesus Christ is our Savior and Lord, everything about our life is important to Him. Everything. All right? How we take care of this physical body. How we take care of our spiritual life. How we take care of our families. How we care about expanding His kingdom. Everything is important to Him. But when we don't give Him access to every area of our lives, we limit it. Let me throw this out to you. Here's what a vision is to our entire life. A vision to our life is like a budget to your finances. Oh, you guys wished I hadn't gone there, huh? How many of you have a budget that directs your financial plan? Raise your hand. Okay, guys, you see that's less than half of you. Quick scolding. Rest of y'all need to get a budget. You need to take financial peace. Mark, get ready to teach another class, all right? We're going to need it real soon, all right? Conviction is going to overwhelm this audience, all right? You need to have a budget because you have no idea how you're spending God's resources without the budget. And more than likely, you're probably ignoring God in the process if you don't have a budget. A budget to finances is what vision is to our life. It lets us know that this is the will of God for our life. We limit God when we focus on what we can't, forgetting that He didn't tell us that we could. But He always said, He can. And He will in our lives. He can change our can'ts to can when we turn Him loose. When we see a need, this is how we limit God. When we see a need and we go to the pastor and say, hey, pastor, have you thought about starting this ministry? Hey, pastor, so-and-so is having surgery. Don't you think you ought to go see him? Hey, so-and-so is sick. I think it would be great if somebody took them some food. And you're telling me? Who did God speak to? You. You are able. You might say it was a, hey, somebody want to come help me? Or hey, tell me how I can do this. But man, when you recognize a need, that's God speaking to you. The Word tells us that we are to walk by faith and not by sight. Our vision must be Spirit-born and Spirit-fed and Spirit-led if anything's going to be accomplished of worthwhile in our lives. How does someone get a vision? How do we get a vision? Two things are essential. One, we must take a good look at God. We must know who He is. We must know what His character is like, because then when He says, just believe, we know that we can trust Him. But if we don't know much about Him, we can't. I came across a sign quite some time ago that said this, a good eye is one that looks to God. And I would say that's pretty true. Once we understand how awesome God is, we will not hesitate to pursue the adventure that God plans out for us. So, how do we get a vision? Take a good look at God. Number two, take a good look around us. What are the needs of those around us? What are the hurts? What are the habits? What are the hang-ups? Sounds kind of like Celebrate Recovery, doesn't it? Everybody qualifies to go. Everybody qualifies to be engaged. Why? Because there's hurts, habits, and hang-ups all around us. What do we see? What do we notice? What touches our heart? That's a good place. Once we've seen God and what He's able to do, look at what are the needs around us, because God wants to use us in the area of their need. Martha Berry was a lady who had a vision to help poor children. She began a school for them. She began a school, though she had no books, no building, and no money. What she had was a dream. She went to the wealthiest man she knew. He was pretty wealthy. I don't know if any of you guys recognize the name of Henry Ford. She went to him and asked for a donation. Mr. Ford reached into his pocket, and he gave Martha Berry a dime. One thin dime. Most of us would have been insulted by that. Here's a multimillionaire, and all he could give was a dime. But Martha took that dime, and she bought a packet of seeds, and she planted a garden. She raised a crop, she sold it, and she bought more seeds. After about five different harvests, she had enough money to purchase an old building for the children. She returned to Mr. Ford and she said, "Look what your dime has done." And the man was so impressed, this time he gave her $1 million. See what can happen when you get off the dime? I came up with that one all by myself too today. I'm on a roll, man. Moms, it's Mother's Day. And I want to make this personal for just a brief bit. And men, you're not excluded. Just kick the mother out. And don't literally kick mom out, but kick the word mother and say me, father. But look around, moms. Look around, dads. Are you as concerned about your children's faith in Jesus Christ as you are the degree they're going to get from a college? Do you ask your kids when you pick them up from Sunday school after service today, "Hey, what'd you learn today?" Do you ever stop and ask the Sunday school teacher, "How's my kid doing in your class? Does she pay attention? Does he mind?" I know those are questions we don't want to hear the answers to sometimes. I've been there. But do you care enough? Or is that just daycare today? Or do you realize that is spiritual education that lasts for eternity? Do you sit down with your kids and help them learn a weekly memory verse? Most of the verses that I have here, I learned before I was 10 years of age. I had a mama who set me down and a daddy who set me down almost every night, and we learned the memory verse. If I didn't know it by Wednesday, I was in trouble. You sit down and teach your kids 2 times 2 and 3 times 3. You take them out and you throw them baseballs and footballs and softballs. Do you sit down with them and teach them the Word of God? Are you more concerned with your kids' social life, athletic abilities, or their spiritual development? Do you care about them being God's all-star as much as you do the team's all-star? Guys, you know, I'm not opposed to sports. I'm not opposed to education. But I had a mama who had it right. I can't take no credit. Any credit for my life having value today, it comes from a mom and a dad who had priorities right. I ran track for 6 years, junior high through high school. For 14 days, I held a state record. I wrestled for 6 years, played football for 2. My mama never saw me do any of those things. And I wasn't neglected. My dad saw some of it. But I tell you what, my mama saw that the memory verses were learned. Mama saw that the Bible stories were taught. Mama saw that the application of those verses and those stories had relevance to my life. And that's what made it possible. On the day before my mama died at Heinz Hospice Home, when I did not want to leave her bedside, but I had 2 funerals to go preach, and I told her, "Mama, I don't want to go." And she looked at me with a smile on her face and she said, "You go give those folks hope, because we've got more than we need." That doesn't happen because I did well in school. It happened because God was doing well in our family. Do you do that with your kids? You prepare meals so that your kids get physically fed? Do you give them nourishment from God's Word? Many parents are concerned about leaving an inheritance to their children, but how about a spiritual legacy that will last for eternity? James 4:17, the brother of Jesus wrote this, "If anyone then knows the good they ought to do, and they don't do it," what's the rest of the verse? "To them it is sin." Drive that home a moment, folks. To you who, not me telling you what is good, do you listen to the vision, the purpose, the plan of God for your own life? If God has conveyed something to you and says, this is good, and you don't do it, do you get the impact of what James is saying? It's like adultery. It's like lying. It's like robbing the bank. If you know this is right and you don't do it, it is sin. 1 Timothy 6:18 and 19 says, "Command them to do good, be rich in good deeds, to be generous and willing to share, and in this way they will lay up treasures for themselves as a firm foundation for the coming age, so that they may take hold of life, that which is truly life." They will lay up treasures in the coming age, for that is truly life. Being the homecoming queen, being the homecoming king, being the star quarterback, being an outstanding, that's not truly life. Nothing wrong with it. That is not truly life. How does someone get a vision? I already told you that. Next, 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17, all scripture is God-breathed. It's useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, training in righteousness. Why? So that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. Bruce Lee. Anybody not know who Bruce Lee is? Okay. Do you guys know who Bruce Lee is? It's okay if you don't. I'm just old, okay? It's all right. Okay, if you're under 20, man. Bruce Lee, who would be like Bruce Lee, they would know? Chuck Norris is old too. Texas Ranger? Okay, who? Jackie Chan. Okay, Jackie Chan. Bruce Lee's the original Jackie Chan, all right, the original. Bruce Lee had a fighting style that was very unique. His unique concept that he kind of created on his own was whatever it was that he wanted to hit, he didn't look at his target. He looked 6 inches the other side of the target. So in other words, if he wanted to hit me in the nose, he aimed for the back of my head. He wanted to drive through the target. What a concept for Christians. Reaching beyond our own abilities. Most of the time, we aim 6 inches short. We want to make sure we are more than able to accomplish something. We evaluate it from our own. God says, no, aim beyond that, because I am able to do abundantly beyond what you could ever hope or ask. A vision is the ability to see. Number two, a vision includes faith to believe. Romans, as God, oh my, God helps us to have enough faith in God to believe Himself. That story in Mark, when Jesus said to Jairus, don't be afraid, believe. Do you know what Jairus said back to Jesus? He said, Lord, I believe, but help my unbelief. You see, if you want your faith to grow, that's okay. Ask God. That which He asks of you, He'll provide for you. So say, hey, God, I believe, but I'm still scared. I want more. Okay. He'll give us more faith. He'll strengthen our faith. We forget that God will and does provide us everything, and that includes helping our faith grow stronger. And how does this work? Our faith grows stronger through the knowledge of His Word. Our faith will go stronger through the trusting in His Word. And our faith will go stronger to the obedience to His Word. Philippians 4:13 says, I can do all things through Christ who is my strength. There are a lot of factors that influence our service for God, which we have no control over. We can't control our background, our age, our giftedness, but there is one important factor that we do have control over: how much we choose to believe that God is able. We sing that song, He is able to deliver me. Do we really believe that? There was a fifth grade Sunday school class asked to go home and count the stars in the sky as part of their next Sunday school lesson. They came back with a lot of different numbers. One kid said 100. Another boy said 1,000. Another girl said over 1,000,000. Finally, a teacher asked a little boy who had said nothing, "How many stars did you count?" He said, "Three." Teacher said, "How did you only see three?" He said, "I guess our backyard is too small." I want to suggest to you, a lot of us maybe have too small a backyard. We don't believe what God can do. A vision is the ability to see. A vision includes faith to believe. And last of all, a vision includes the courage to do. Faith in action. Courage is going forward in spite of our fear. Or John Wayne said it this way, courage is being afraid but saddling up anyway. Was David afraid when he faced Goliath? Probably. But he knew the outcome of that battle was not his problem. Our problem is too often we want to stay in the comfort zone because we think the outcome is our problem. The outcome is not our problem. The outcome is God's responsibility. Our problem is saying yes to the vision that God gives to us. Look at how God has worked through most of our heroes in the Bible. He took them out of human control, though they still needed to be available. Abraham and Sarah told at old age, "You're going to have a baby." They had never had a baby before. Now they're old. He kept telling Abraham, "You keep practicing, son. One of these days you'll get it right." 15 years passed. He still hadn't got it right. God says, "Keep going." And at 100 years of age, "You're not even that old, Lee." See, God can still use every single one of you. Joshua, his first battle was a town called Jericho. God said, "I'm going to bring those walls down. All you got to do is sing and shout." Doesn't sound reasonable, does it? It's not logical, is it? Joshua did it. God did it. Esther, young girl, she became the queen of a nation because she won a beauty contest. And she eventually saved her nation because she was willing to have an attitude that said, "If I perish, I perish." And she went before her husband without being called. And she asked him to save her people. A virgin to have a baby? Impossible. But Mary's attitude was, "God, do with me what you want." An infant church in the first century, led by a ragtag group of fishermen, tax collectors, betrayers, and former hookers and secret believers. And what did that group do? They turned the world upside down and became the most powerful force in history. And the effects are still being felt today. And you're part of the results of what they started 2,000 years ago. What are the opportunities here at New Hope if we have the vision? How about we just start responding to the needs around us? Would that be a good place? Do you guys realize there's been an ad in your bulletin for 3 months for a Sunday school teacher? To teach our kids first, second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth grade of age. "Oh, Tim, I've done that for a lot of years." So, you've been breathing your entire life. You're going to stop? Not till God says you're going to stop. "Ah, Tim, I'm not very good with kids." So, has God put that vision in your heart? What else? How about leading a small group? How about joining a small group? Relating to some other people. How about volunteering to help with prison ministries? You can go to women's prisons, men's prison. You can teach them out of the Word of God. You can be taught how to teach them. And guys, here's the deal. You can say, "Tim, I might not be good at it." That's okay. It's okay not to be good. If you go, they're going to sense that you care about them. And you know what? Whether you're good or not, they will show up every week, won't they? Where else are they going to go? So they will show up. And I promise you, if you keep it up, you'll get good at it. Because God will be good in you. How about buying or donating a home for recently paroled women? I'm not off that kick yet, guys. Just because it hasn't happened doesn't mean it shouldn't be the vision of this church. How about mentoring a troubled teen? How about going on a mission trip, Mexico, Colombia, Africa, pick someplace? How about giving up your seat for a visitor? How about ministering to the homeless? How about adopting a church that is orphaned? Coway may be back in the picture. We so often want to keep a hold on things we can physically change or alter. We want to never reach beyond the limit of our own scope. We must reach out and let God display His handiwork in our lives. What if Babel heroes did not move beyond their comfort zones? Noah would have said, "Sorry, God, I don't do boats." Moses would have said, "I don't like people." In fact, he did say that. God said, "Go anyway." David said, I don't do giants or kingdoms, I'm just a shepherd. Mary said, I don't do babies. I want to tell you this, folks, the biggest Goliath in most of our lives is ourselves. We wake up and look in the mirror every day and we see the same person we saw the day before. We don't look 6 inches beyond the reflection and see God's handiwork. Why is it that we don't have more faith, courage, and vision? I suggest to you it is not God's fault. In fact, if we could kick the person responsible for our doubts, none of us could sit for a week. That one actually was kind of funny too. Unless it hurt too badly. You see, God helps us to be courageous in the tasks before us. There's an old saying, the road ahead is paved with... Yeah, time for good intentions is over, folks. It is time for good decisions and great faith. 1 Timothy 6:12 says, fight the good fight of faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called, and you made your good profession in the presence of many witnesses. And the same writer in 2 Timothy 4:7 and 8 says, I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. And now there is in store for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day. And not only to me, but to those who have longed for His appearing. Vision's the ability to see what others can't. Faith to believe what others will not. Courage is to do what others said can't be done. Columbus's diary on the ship appeared to be repetitive. Page after page after page after page said the same thing. This day we sailed on. What a great motto for us. Sail on, young man. Sail on, old woman. Sail on. God's not finished. You may discover a new country. You may find a vision for your life. You may find a ministry to children. You may find a ministry in your church. You may find a ministry for the lost. With this, I'll close. Randy Frazee, who was part author of the story, wrote a book called The Connecting Church. He has a son who was born without a left hand. One day in Sunday school, the teacher was talking with the children about church, and to illustrate her point, she folded her hands together and said, here's the church. Here's the steeple. Open the doors and see all the people. She asked the class to go along with her, obviously not thinking about Frazee's son who was missing a left hand. And she said, I want you to put your hands together and do this with me. She realized she had made a big mistake. Before she could do anything about it, though, the boy sitting next to Frazee's son had been his friend since they were babies. And that boy reached out with his left hand and he reached over to Randy's son who had only a right hand. And he said, here, let's do it together. And they put their hands together and they said, here's the church and here's the steeple and let's open the doors and let's see all the people. And folks, I suggest to you, this is the only way this illustration ought to be taught. It ought to be done together and never by ourselves. For the church is us, seeing the vision God has for us. And even though we know we can't accomplish His purpose, we believe that He can. He says, believe. And you and I should say, Lord, I will. Help my unbelief. Let's pray. God, I don't know what vision you have in store for all of us and for each of us. But I pray what we will have found today, what you will have found today, are more men, more women, more young people who will say, Lord, I want your vision in my life. And if God's calling you to preach at 15, say yes. And if God's calling you to a mission field at age 40, say yes. And if God is calling you across the block to a neighbor at age 80, go. If it's to a Sunday school room, if it's to a choir rehearsal, whatever your vision, Father, may you hear a lot of yes. 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 In Jesus' name, amen.